this presentation, began with the conclusions drawn by Will Durant, based on his lifetime of study in history. He believed that religion was necessary for the establishment and cultivation of morality and civilization. It also addresses some of the religious criticisms, particularly the argument that religion has a negative influence on society, and then more feasible, I've used Durant's own words. Okay, so who is Will Durant? Again, his 1926 book, The Sword of Philosophy, launched Simon & Schuster, the publishing company. It's credited with introducing more period of philosophy than any other book. He received the Pulitzer Prize and the Presidential Medal of Freedom for his 11-volume story of civilization. And he was one of the most prolific lecturers of his time. One of the things I've done in the past year is document his lectures. And some archive research. And so far, I've managed to document over 500 lectures. And I think that would probably represent about 25% of his total. This quote represents Durant's view of the problem of morality in the 20th century. Durant was deeply concerned about the subject of morality. He felt like the 20th century was a period of tremendous change, the diminishment of religious faith was leading to the loosening of morals. And so many of his lectures, the lectures that I identified, 62% touched upon morality, whether directly as the subject of the lecture or indirectly as one of the subtopics. So why is this view important? He's unique in that he spent five decades developing an integral view of human history. So what he referred to as integral meant that he saw history as one long narrative, whereas many historians are more focused on specific areas of history. He looked at history in the full breadth of civilization. And he was one of the most prominent atheists of the 20th century. So that makes this really fascinating because, as one of the most prominent atheists, he was a defender of religious faith, although he did not believe himself. Durant defined morality as cooperation of the part with the whole. He said the greatest morality is the most cooperation with the largest part. And Durant developed a moral theory through his study of history, which he called Puritanism versus Paganism. Durant believed that throughout history, civilization goes through cycles of conservatism and liberalism. And he believed that the 20th century we were entering a period of paganism that started with Darwin. And again, he frequently addressed the subject of morality in his lectures. And what you see there is an advertisement from the 40s for a radio debate that he was a participant on concerning morality. So his historical view of the necessity of religion. Durant said that individualistic instincts were formed in the hunting stage of human development over thousands of years. And social instincts were formed in the agricultural stage, which was only about 25,000 years. So in his view, social instincts were weaker than individualistic instincts.
In agriculture, those hunting qualities of pugnacity, aggressiveness, sexual voracity, which were once virtues because they were necessary to survival, they became problems. We needed them still in some degree to give vigor to human life and activity, but we had to develop institutions to mitigate those hunting qualities. And that is the problem, the persistent problem of civilization, is by what institutions have we been able to mitigate those hunting qualities so that they might be useful but not excessive, not dangerous to us. And we had to develop social impulses, which were partly in our blood in the sense that we inherit the affection of a man for a woman, and perhaps the family. You might say that they are biologically rooted, but civilization is not biologically rooted. It depends upon the development of the mind, educational systems. It depends upon religious belief. It depends upon social organization through the community and the state.
I found it interesting, he barely moves his mouth when he speaks. He would drive a delivery crazy. So religion will have community to flourish by developing a moral code that suppresses the individualistic instincts. He also pointed out that historically most statesmen have sought the alliance of religion to help keep social order. Now, the picture as an example is Napoleon. He cited Napoleon as an example of this idea because Napoleon was an opponent of the Catholic Church before he rose to power. But within a few years of the rise of power and having governed the people, he formed an alliance with the Church because he recognized that they alone had the ability to really control the population. And religion, you also say that religion is a manner, a means to bear the harsh realities of living. So it is the, as Marx said, the opiate of the masses. And while Marx said that in a negative fashion, Durant argued that that was a good thing. And here's a quote where he kind of expounds on what he was saying to read.
I think woman is the basic transmitter of morals, but she does not fulfill the real function of morals, which is to produce order out of natural chaos in all the fields of human life. We have morals that apply to economics, for example, thou shalt not steal. It has not much to do with the family, but it has a great deal to do with economic order, and thou shalt not kill, and all these, most of the commandments were not for the family, they were for the group. And the evolution of morals has been the enlargement of the area to which the commands apply.
Does religion have a negative influence? Durant was quick to cite the example of Soviet Russia, the great experiment of an atheistic nation. Durant, in his formative years, was a socialist, and he was supportive of the Bolshevik Revolution. And back in the early 30s, he and his wife, who was a Jewish immigrant from Russia, went to the Soviet Union with high hopes of seeing the grand civilization that they envisioned. What they saw instead was a tragedy. In fact, he came back and wrote a book called The Tragedy of Russia in response to that visit. And after that point in time, he gave up socialism. He remained a very liberal Democrat for the remainder of his life. But he saw socialism and communism as a failed philosophy after that. So, and he pointed out that religion need not exist in a society to foster intolerance, violence, and cruelty. Because we saw that in communist Russia under Stalin. An example right here is of a massacre in Russia. 1943, I believe, was the year, and these pictures were taken by the German army who found this. And he argued that religion mitigated the barbarism of the Middle Ages, so that without religion, to develop moral values and to create an omnipotent God that everybody was accountable to, that things would have been much worse than they were in the Middle Ages, that rulers would have been far more cruel. And on the subject of religion, he stated that religion is at its best when it has competition. And since there tends to intolerance when it is unchallenged and supreme, and the example he gave of this was the Reformation, where the Catholic Church went unchallenged at that particular point in time, until Martin Luther came along and challenged him, and the Reformation led to Protestantism and a vast variety of different Christian beliefs. And Catholicism was no longer supreme as a result of that. Instead of the decline of religion today, he's.
Then if you think in terms of ideas, I think the influence of Darwin is still greater than the influence of Marx, but in a different field. And the basic phenomenon of our time is not communism, it's the decline of religious belief, which has all sorts of effects on morals and even on politics, because religion has been a tool of politics, but today it's, in Europe it ceases to be a tool. It has very little influence in determining political decisions. Whereas 500 years ago, the Pope was superior in influence to any civil ruler on earth.
Well, then would you say that the belief or disbelief in superstition is the most important element in the progress and the influence of life?
No, we didn't use the word progress. We just wanted to know what ideas it had the most influence. Whether you consider the influence good or bad, that's a subjective judgment. But to me, the basic event of modern times, from Copernicus through Darwin, and then Nietzsche, has been the decline of Christianity in Europe.
So, comes the question, can we survive without religion? Durant says the moral code is contrary to our individualistic instincts, so that without religion, he wouldn't necessarily say emphatically, but he feared that we would revert back to barbarism and, in his word, chaos. And then he cites attempts at societies without religion, such as the Soviet Union, that have failed. In fact, he made this critical statement. So in Durant's view, in the whole of human history, there's never been a society that's been able to exist and prosper without the supernatural support of the moral code. And let's just expand on it just a little bit. In the very last sentence, important because he's not suggesting that we shouldn't try. He's just suggesting historically it hasn't happened yet. Now, tying this back to the convention theme. I just wanted to point out that I'm part of a group study we're presenting on Saturday involving Hayek. And I noticed when reading his book that he arrived at a few of the same conclusions that Durant had arrived at, but an entirely different manner. So in summary, according to Durant, religion was necessary for the development of morality. No society in history has endured without religious support for morality. And religion is at its best when it is with competition. And finally, religion gave man a means to bear the partialities of life. And to close, tying this again back to the convention theme, I want to say that Will Durant was a perfect example of the theme of respectful disagreement in the divided world. While he was an atheist, unlike many of his peers in the intelligentsia of the 20th century, he respected other people's right to believe, and he found that he could work and collaborate and have civil discourse with people of all faiths, non-faith. And really, he was just a perfect example of the kind of philosophy of trying to get across in this conference.